Meie järgmine ettekanne on professor Mikko Salaspurult atseet aldehüüdist ja maovähist. See on väga põnev teema ja ka väga uus teema meie jaoks, nii et kuulajaskonnalt tähelepanu.
Mrs. Chairman, dear colleagues, first of all, I would like to thank very much Professor Ants Petsalo and the organizers for inviting me to this occasion. I feel myself very honorable and also very delighted. This time I have a couple of days' time to spend here in this lovely city. In this first slide, there is a title of my presentation, and you can see here three take-home messages. Acetaldehyde, you don't find it in textbooks, but it, there is one important reason for that. It is brand new group 1 human carcinogen. Second point is that it is the most common worldwide human carcinogen. Good news is that there are very good possibilities to minimize acetaldehyde exposure, both at the individual and population level. Here you can see also my conflict of interest information. According to Globocan 2012 statistics, gastric cancer in Estonia is still an important health problem. There are close to 400 new cases annually, and this represents 6% of all cancers. It is very well known that stomach cancer has a poor prognosis. The annual mortality here in Estonia is close to 300, and that represents about 8% of all cancer deaths. Accordingly, stomach cancer is number 3 in cancer mortality after lung and colorectal cancers. It is also known that both operative and medicinal treatment of this cancer is challenging, and that means high expenses at the population level and marked psychic and physical suffering, no hope feeling, that is very common. Therefore, main focus should be on the prevention and early detection of stomach cancer. With regard to any cancer, a key to cancer prevention is the identification of specific etiologic factors and or carcinogenic compounds. Here we have some examples of specific human group 1 carcinogens: asbestos, formaldehyde, benzene, tobacco, radon. And we know that the use of each of them is strictly regulated by internationally accepted laws. And there is also a lot of evidence that these directives have been shown to be effective in cancer prevention, again, both at population and individual level. Carcinogenicity of acetaldehyde is based on a unique human cancer model. Comparable human model is not available for any other of the 113 group 1 human carcinogens. And this is due to this gene mutation. This aldehyde dehydrogenase enzyme, called ALDH2, is responsible for the very effective elimination of acetaldehyde formed from ethanol in somatic cells. For instance, in the liver, 100% of acetaldehyde formed from ethanol is eliminated. However, a single point mutation in the gene coding ALDH2 enzyme results in markedly decreased enzyme activity. And this mutation has randomized randomized tens of thousands of alcohol drinking East Asians for decades to markedly increased local exposure to acetaldehyde. And in many epidemiological studies and meta-analyses, it has been convincingly shown that this associates with markedly increased risk for upper digestive tract cancer. So here we have some epidemiological and biochemical facts on ALDH2 deficiency. In this study, Chinese volunteers ingested 0.5 gram or 3 doses of alcohol. They are called flushers here, ALDH2 deficients, and these open circles show those are subjects with normal enzyme. And we can see that the acetaldehyde concentration in the saliva was 2 to 3 times higher than these healthy normals. Difference could be demonstrated to last for the whole follow-up period of 4 hours. And here we have two early studies from 1996 and 1998, which show that relative risk of upper digestive tract cancers in ALDH2 deficient heavy drinkers as compared to heavy drinkers with normal active enzyme ranges from the 11 to 12 fold with regard to oral cavity and esophageal cancer, and about 3.5 with regard to gastric cancer. So this ALDH2 deficiency affects over 500 million East Asians. In homozygotes, ALDH2 enzyme is undetectable. Therefore, it protects many of them from alcoholism because of severe flushing reaction associating with alcohol drinking. However, there are some homozygotes that start to drink, and if they become heavy drinkers or alcoholics, and if they also are smokers, so their risk for esophageal cancer goes up to 400-fold as compared to non-drinkers and teetotalers. In heterozygotes, less than half of the enzyme activity is detectable in most somatic cells. These individuals have less severe flushing reaction, and that is why they may become heavy drinkers and alcoholics. And as I already demonstrated, every time when they drink alcohol, they have markedly elevated acetaldehyde concentrations ranging from 2.5 to 5.6 fold in the saliva and gastric juice after drinking of alcohol. And as already pointed out, this associates with markedly increased upper digestive tract gas risk. As already mentioned, acetaldehyde is the most widespread human carcinogen. And why? It is present in most alcoholic beverages and foodstuffs produced or preserved by fermentation. It is also widely used as an aroma agent and food additive. It is also the most abundant carcinogen of tobacco smoke, and it becomes easily dissolved into the saliva, and by that means it is distributed to the mucosal surfaces of oral cavity, pharynx, and stomach. Ethanol as a molecule is not carcinogenic, and the carcinogenicity associated with the use of alcoholic beverages is mediated via acetaldehyde. And this concerns both the acetaldehyde that is present as a free form in many alcoholic beverages. Very high concentrations can be detected, for instance, in grappa, calvados, and also in some very strong rice wines used widely in East Asian countries. On the other hand, free acetaldehyde is also formed from the oxidation of ethanol locally in the upper digestive tract by normal microbial oral flora and mucosal cells. Already for about 25 years ago, it was demonstrated that acetaldehyde is carcinogenic to animals. And in 2009 2012, International Agency for Research on Cancer, WHO branch, concluded that acetaldehyde associated with alcoholic beverages is carcinogenic to humans, group 1. And in this conclusion, they reported that there exists a causal relationship between alcohol-associated acetaldehyde and upper digestive tract cancers, and that has been demonstrated in gene epidemiological and biochemical studies. Acetaldehyde has an apple or orange flavor. That is why it is used as a food additive and aroma agent. Its boiling point is close to the room temperature, and it is a small molecule that is easily soluble to water and lipids. Therefore, it passes without difficulty through cell membranes and attacks DNA, forming acetaldehyde DNA adducts. And most of those, or many of those adducts, are mutagenic. What is very important to realize that acetaldehyde accumulates in saliva and gastric juice. Liver takes almost all of it away. Here on the right-hand side, you can see ethanol, let's say it is in saliva. And here we have microbes and mucosal cells, and they both possess alcohol dehydrogenase enzyme activity, and therefore they are able to form acetaldehyde, which accumulates in saliva and gastric juice. That is because mucosa and microbes have a very low capacity to eliminate acetaldehyde. And that is why we have highest concentrations of the alcohol intake just in saliva and gastric juice. As Pentti already told us, atrophic gastritis is a major risk factor for stomach cancer. According to a recent meta-analysis, also the use of gastric secretion inhibitors, PPI drugs, increase the risk of gastric cancer. Both conditions are characterized by hypochlorhydria or acid-free stomach, and in under those conditions, oral microbes, normal oral microbes, are able to survive and multiply. And as already mentioned, many of those microbes possess alcohol dehydrogenase enzyme and produce effectively acetaldehyde from any ethanol present in the oral cavity or in the stomach. On the other hand, also glucose may serve as a substrate for acetaldehyde production. Here we have an early study done in patients with achlorhydric gastritis. These blue columns, so they had normal healthy mucosa in their stomach, and these one were achlorhydrics, and before the experiment they received a moderate dose of ethanol as a 15% dissolution, and we can see the highly elevated acetaldehyde levels in gastric juice both after 30 minutes and 60 minutes after the beginning of the study. What is very important, so acetaldehyde exposure can be minimized markedly and by many ways, both at the population and individual level. Most important is try to quit from smoking and try to moderate one's alcohol consumption. Also, one should try to avoid beverages and foodstuffs containing high concentrations of free acetaldehyde and or even low concentrations of alcohol. A novel approach is slowly L-cysteine-releasing capsule acetium, and this L-cysteine formulation binds and inactivates from 60% to 70% of intragastric acetaldehyde after alcohol intake. As you very well know, L-cysteine is a semi-essential sulfur-containing amino acid. Mean daily intake ranges from 1 to 2 grams. In those who are using high-protein diets, it may go up to 6 grams every day. But what is important with regard to acetaldehyde, L-cysteine binds in seconds covalently and non-enzymatically acetaldehyde and forms inactive 4-methyl-thiazolidine carboxylic acid. Here we can see this acetaldehyde. This CHO is the active reactive part of the molecule. Here we have L-cysteine, and here we have inactive and unabsorbable MTCA. Here is one of the first studies on this drug formulation. In this study, there were patients with atrophic gastritis, and you can see here the nasogastric tube, 15% ethanol, microbes, and acetium capsules. And we can see that in these subjects here, after giving them some ethanol and placebo, we can see how gastric juice acetaldehyde levels increase during this 40-minute follow-up period. But when they are receiving cysteine, we can see that it binds from 60% to 70% of that acetaldehyde seen in the gastric juice after alcohol administration. These results have recently been confirmed in a Japanese-Finnish study. In this study, there were patients with ALDH2 deficiency who, in addition, received PPI drugs for 7 days, so that it was possible to demonstrate a lot of microbes in their gastric juice. And when they were given a moderate dose of alcohol, 0.5 gram per kilogram, so we can see how gastric juice acetaldehyde concentrations go up. But if they receive also L-cysteine capsules, so they are much lower. And we can find that this acetium formulation eliminated some 60% or gastric juice acetaldehyde, and the effect of the capsule continued for the whole follow-up period of 2 hours. This result has also been confirmed recently in Uppsala, and in this study, these patients were those with atrophic gastritis, and they were given alcohol, small dose, 0.3 gram per kilogram, and acetium capsules, 2 acetium capsules containing 100 milligram each L-cysteine. And we can see here we have this placebo data, and here L-cysteine data. We can see that this L-cysteine formulation decreased almost 70% of acetaldehyde. And this is area under the curve calculation on the right-hand side here. And also in this Uppsala study, it was possible to demonstrate that acetium or L-cysteine released from capsules stay in the stomach for up to 3 hours after its intake. And we can see also that MTCA stays there also for up to 180 hours. So acetium capsule, that is a novel innovation. Each capsule contains 100 milligram of slowly released L-cysteine, and that takes place exactly in the place where also acetaldehyde is formed. And the main indications for acetium are individuals with atrophic gastritis, so you should be able to make the diagnosis. Also, another indication is long-term use of PPI drugs. Operated stomach that is acid-free and that is colonized with oral microbes. And also chronic Helicobacter pylori infection, because most strains of Helicobacter pylori has very high alcohol dehydrogenase activity, and also they are able to produce locally acetaldehyde from ethanol. So here are the main conclusions of this presentation. Carcinogenicity of acetaldehyde is based on a unique genetic human model. It is comparable to familial hypercholesterolemia. Acetaldehyde is the most common and most prevalent human carcinogen. We have it everywhere in our environment. Atrophic gastritis resulting in hypochlorhydric or acid-free stomach is the most important risk factor for stomach cancer. And acid-free stomach is colonized by oral microbes producing mutagenic concentrations of acetaldehyde from any ethanol in the stomach and also from glucose. And what this any ethanol means? Naturally, we have alcoholic beverages, but we have also a lot of foodstuffs that contain lower levels of ethanol, and they are not classified as alcoholic beverages. For instance, soya sauces. All of them contain from 1% to up to 5% concentrations of alcohol. And they are widely used all over the world. Slowly, aldosterone-releasing acetium capsule eliminates from 60 to 70% of gastric juice acetaldehyde after alcohol drinking. And finally, acetium capsule is so far the only commercially available product for the local elimination of this new carcinogen in those patients with achlorhydria or atrophic gastritis. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Põnev. Küsimused. Enti.
In the history, it has been said that nitrosoamines are carcinogens in atrophic gastritis, acid-free stomach. It has been a very popular to emphasize the nitrosoamines. Do you believe that they are carcinogens at all, or how they are related to acetaldehyde?
Thank you, Pentti. That was very important and good question. As a matter of fact, I was very happy when I saw that you did not mention in your presentation nitrosoamines. You had only acetaldehyde as a main carcinogenic product in patients with atrophic gastritis. Indeed, that is a very old hypothesis expressed by Correa already in 1975. And he did some studies in which he was able to demonstrate that some of those nitrosoamines are metabolized by microbes and produce some carcinogenic compounds. As a matter of fact, there are almost 10 different types of nitrosoamines, and only one of them is group 1 carcinogenic to humans. And nobody has never demonstrated that nitrosoamine stays in gastric juice. On the other hand, there are a lot of epidemiological studies in which people have tried to calculate individual intake of nitrosoamines. And do you know what is the best source for nitrosoamines? They are preserved vegetables, pickled vegetables, preserved fish, all of these produced by fermentation. So there is no way to differentiate between nitrate intake and acetaldehyde or ethanol intake, because they are that is a very important confounding factor in those studies. So that is why I think, and on the other hand, also those results are controversial. It has been able to demonstrate a positive association in some studies, but in many studies not. So I think that is outdated information, and now we have very convincing results on acetaldehyde, and I think that we should try to focus on that in the future.
Thank you. Kas on küsimusi veel? Jaa. Kohe tuleb mikrofon.
Thank you, very interesting presentation. As you mentioned, there are some specific drinks which contain more acetaldehyde, like a, if I heard correctly, grappa and what the apple drink. Anyway, what do you think? Is it useful to label that fact to the product? I mean, when we know how many percentage is in alcohol inside, we should also know maybe that this is a bit more dangerous than other drinks.
For very practical question.
That is very very important question, and absolutely we should do it because we know that acetaldehyde associated with the use of alcoholic beverages is group 1 carcinogen. Or every consumer should be able to know how much free acetaldehyde is in the product what he or she is using. And just recently, a couple of days, there was a special committee in European Union, European Parliament, and they proposed that EFSA, European Food Safety Authority, has to immediately reassess the safety of acetaldehyde in alcoholic beverages and also in non-alcoholic beverages. And also, those who are producing alcoholic beverages or any other foodstuffs produced by fermentation, so they should consider just labeling or giving in information to consumers in the label. So I think it is very important point, and I hope that both Finland and Estonia, we can support that idea when it goes further to the European Commission and European Food Safety Authority located in Parma, Italy.
Niin, palun, kas on küsimusi vielä? I'd like to ask one practical question also. Do you think that it's useful to measure ALDH2 activity in everyday practice?
Yeah, that is also. The, actually, the point is that gene mutation, fortunately for us Caucasians, so that took place in southeast China, and it has been estimated that the mutation was prevalent there already about 2,500 years ago. Pinyu tribe that was there, so they had that mutation, and the frequency of that gene mutation in that area is still about 65%. But during the Han Dynasty, so the mutation went further to China, Korea, Vietnam, Taiwan, and also to Japan. And in those countries, for instance, in Japan, the incidence of that gene mutation is about 35%. So this is just a major problem of East Asian countries. But this, most importantly, that serves us as a model for the toxicity or carcinogenicity of acetaldehyde. We all produce acetaldehyde from any alcohol we are drinking, but less. And that is why we are also in the danger. More we are drinking, more we are smoking, more we have acetaldehyde exposure and more risk of upper digestive cancers. So it is not necessary to genotype this mutation in a Caucasian population. You have to do it if you have roots in Eastern Asia. But on the other hand, a couple of years ago, it was reported from Poland. They found another ALDH2 mutation. And that is working also among us. So I think that in future, we are maybe able to also find some risk groups among special risk groups in addition to atrophic gastritis among Caucasian populations. And on the other hand, about 5% of us also here, so we have another gene mutation, and that is in alcohol dehydrogenase enzyme. And that means that in those people who have that mutation, so they have abnormally high alcohol dehydrogenase activity in their mucosal and salivary gland cells. And if they drink alcohol, so they produce more acetaldehyde. And they have also elevated acetaldehyde levels after drinking of alcohol in their saliva. And that is an established risk group already. And that has been published in collaboration with a German group and our group. So I think that in the future, we are going to pay more attention also to these gene mutations in order to find risk groups and to give health advice for them. And naturally, it becomes more and more easier when those tests become cheaper and cheaper.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.